So, after a couple of months hard work, I created my first commit. I basically recorded almost the whole process that got me to the point where I am now. The last 2 days I have not recorded because it was a little bit chaotic, and it was also at that point pretty boring because it was more like cosmetic. And just today I just added on support for GNOME Shell Classic mode, which was which took a little some changes, not much. I should have probably recorded that because it was interesting. Basically, XDM runs the SSH agent, or X-Session probably runs SSH agent, and SSH agent runs G session, GNOME session, which runs the shell. And so I had to put in some transitions, and also there were some slight changes with regard to GNOME Classic, whereas GNOME Classic has Nautilus on the desktop, Nautilus icons on the desktop, and GNOME Shell does not, the new GNOME Shell does not. And there were some other minor things, so I had to basically expand the SSH agent domain quite a bit. I had to add some changes to Nautilus domain and GNOME Shell domain. I added a little, a few more permissions, for example, read XDG, config home files, and also read GTK bookmarks and list GTK bookmarks. So yeah, the policy might still have bugs, of course. Might I'm just sure there's plenty bugs in there still, but it's pretty decent. So the commit message is that the policy should work on Fedora 18 and 19 virtual machines. That means I haven't actually tested this on bare metal. That's the next thing I will do. It's just load this policy onto my laptop, which has a few more session daemons and a few more applets, like for example Bluetooth applet and Power Manager applet, and well, it has wireless, so wireless support should probably be built in. So only GNOME Shell graphical user interface support, so this won't work on KDE, LXDE, or any other stuff. Well, it might actually, no, it won't work. There won't be any domain transitions out of the user domain. So X-Session will run as the user, and then you will, and then the system will try to run the graphical user interface in the user domain, which does not have appropriate permissions, needless to say, because that's a very limited domain. No support yet for laptop-specific applets, and session daemons like Power Manager. So I just explained that. So the policy should support SSH console and XDM logins, although I haven't actually tested SSH in console logins recently, but initially that worked. So I assume that that still works. If it doesn't, then that needs fixing. And there are various booleans that you can use to actually toggle on and off the SSH console and XDM logins. By default, they are enabled, they are permitted, so you can log in using SSH console and XDM. But see the booleans here, as you manage boolean, and I think it's boolean instead of booleans, list, and then grab my login user, and you'll see every my login user related boolean that you can toggle. The policy should integrate flawlessly into existing SELinux policies. So the goal of this policy was for me to actually make it so that on the one hand, it integrates flawlessly into existing Fedora policies, so my other users that aren't mapped to my login user should work as normal. And on the other hand, wanted to basically rely as little as possible on existing APIs, because the APIs that are existing in Fedora are a bit too coarse for my taste. So I just decided, and also not just because they are a bit coarse, but also I wanted to make my policy self-contained. That means that you can basically find all the characteristics of the policy by just looking at the policy module, the source policy module. You don't have to reference any other policy to actually see what's happening. And there are, of course, a few exceptions to that rule. But my goal was to, at least to the extent possible, to basically make it self-contained, so that everything is in this policy that you need, and so you don't actually need any knowledge of the Fedora policy itself. Well, there are some exceptions, like I said. Application domains are all domain classified domain, so that is basically the domain type attribute is basically defined in Fedora policy, so there are rules related to that type attribute, and so you should look that up, what it means to be a domain in Fedora policy. And the same goes for some other existing attributes like file type, exec type attributes, and application exec type attribute, and a couple of more of those. And user temp type, user tempfs type, and user home type. Those are also type attributes that I use. But other than that, I declared my own type attributes, so it's all basically in this policy. As you can see here, the global declarations have a shitload of attributes, which are basically defined in this policy, so you can look them up, what they mean. So if you want to know what read fonts mean, then you go to the MISC files section and see what rules apply to sources that have read fonts type attribute assigned to them. So that's for that. So self-contained. So how to enable it? Oh yeah, and you should expect bugs, needless to say. I tested it on my system pretty extensively, but there's always bugs, always. And there's always something I overlooked or something that changed in the meanwhile, because Fedora is a moving target, and if you use Fedora 19, you'll get updates every day, and also related to GNOME, so stuff might change. Anyways, to enable, you basically compile the module, so you basically get the file context file and the type enforcement file, put it in a directory, compile it, then basically load it into the system SE module. Then you create an SE Linux user mapping. Basically, you only map the MyLogin role to the MyLogin user underscore you SE Linux user. You don't use MCS. This policy does not have yet MCS support, but the idea is to make these processes, my login user processes, also MCS constrained, so that you can basically have various different users that are all my login user that basically can't access each other's resources, because they are both mapped to different categories. Although I'm not sure if that's going to work the way I like it to work, and also not sure if it's feasible. But anyways, no support for MCS yet, so only map the system low level and ranges to the SE Linux user and login mapping. So basically support for SSH, local login, and XDM. So you create a default context file for the user. Not sure if this is actually needed, but just to be sure, I just added it in, and that basically tells PAM SE Linux, okay, this is the default context of this user, and it tells SSH, okay, this is the default context for the user. It tells local login, so that's console, that this is the default context for the user, and XDM, same shit. So then you add a user, then you add a password for the user, and then here is an interesting one: user mod add group wheel to my login user. So basically, this is optional, but basically, the idea is that this policy should just be a normal session at least from a graphical user interface perspective. So the user should be able to do anything that's, at least not anything, but yeah, well actually it should do anything that's available that in a normal session. So that's why I basically added the group wheel, so that you can actually run, for example, the log viewer program in GNOME, which basically requires that you are a wheel, that you are administrator, but you basically run it all confined. So the idea is not to restrict users or to cripple users. That's not the idea. The idea is to basically contain the processes and make sure that the processes only do what they need to do, and basically provide some integrity on the content of the user and stuff like that. So optional, if you want the user to have full functionality, just map it to wheel. You won't be able to use sudo, so you don't have to worry about him being able, and even if he was allowed to use sudo, then still wouldn't be a problem, because he would run sudo in the my login user domain, which is basically very limited, so it wouldn't matter. But he doesn't have access to sudo from Ethelene's perspective, so no worries there. But he will be able to run pkexec, and he will be able to use a policy kit out to authenticate and run SUID applications. So, and then basically you map the SE Linux user to the Linux user which you created here. And then basically here's another interesting one. You basically echo the MyLogin user name into etc security's SE pyramid. I haven't actually tested this, but this is also used for xguest. Basically it means that the user won't be able to log in if SE Linux is in permissive mode. So that's basically an fail-safe, actually, so that if for some reason SE Linux is not enabled or is in permissive mode, then the user won't be able to log in. And that's pretty important, because we rely on the first and last line of defense for for security on SE Linux. So you need to make sure that it's enabled, and this will basically add some extra protection, so that the user won't be able to log in if it's not enabled. And then basically important to relabel the file system. You don't actually need to do the fix files on boot and reboot. You can basically restore con every path in the file context file. And that's basically the only things those are basically the only things that should change. So if you just do manual restore con recursive and force on all the paths, on all the paths here, then you'll be fine. And you might also want to try to restore con the user home directory, although it should be created clean, but just in case for that the bash login files are labeled properly, which are basically copied over by the what's the program called, copied over from etc scale by probably user add. So that should probably actually be restored as well, your bash files, else your shell won't be able to read your bash stuff. So anyways, like I said, it should basically work. Get a force. So in the previous sections I just or in the previous episodes of my screencast, I've actually showed you all the functionality that it should provide. Now there were some changes, but nonetheless the stuff should generally be still the same. So you can just log in. I'm not going to show everything, but I'm just going to show you that both sessions should be supported, at least hopefully, and we'll check that out. And that the default login is supported. So So here you have it. You log in, we're in a forcing mode, and there's no ABC denials. And so stuff like this should work. Now, as you can see, there's very little in the menu, and that's not because I have very little stuff installed. This is basically one nice feature, and I already discussed that, but I'll discuss it once again, that basically I'm just allowing GNOME to only get the attributes and check for execute on the apps that it actually can run. So every application that's installed on the system that's not supported, so to speak, it just doesn't list it, because as far as GNOME is concerned, it's just not there. But it's there, so that basically as soon as you, for example, add support for Mozilla browser, then it will show up in the menu. But everything else that's not supported will not show up in the menu. So that's nice. So that basically won't put you in a situation where you're executing something that you aren't allowed to execute. All this stuff here should work. Simple as that. So here the system monitor, it just works. Although there might actually be ABC denials. And this stuff, it all just works. So the functionality, the stuff that you can access, should, at least to some extent, work. And if you can't, there are some exceptions. For example, network manager applet, so it just won't run. There's no AVC denials, there's no access denied or anything else. It just won't do it. So same for this stuff here. So that's pretty neat. You won't have any messages, because it's just not allowed to run it. So the user experience should be just like normal. That's the idea, the goal. Should be just like you would on a system with no AC Linux. And if that experience is like that, then I achieved my goal, so to speak. So that's basically. Also, this also works. Pretty neat. Log out. And let's try the normal shell once more, and then I prove that in my system it works. And then the normal session. And that's also work. So in the same properties, you can't run all these programs. So that works. And then just another test to show you before I quit is basically proven that it integrates well into Fedora. I'll just log into my normal user account, which is unconfined, and with a normal session, and then so the session just works, all the functionality works. But if you look now, you see that there's plenty more applications available, because this is an unconfined domain. So GNOME Shell just has access to all these applications. That's why it's showing them all in the menu. So that's the difference between the confined user and the unconfined user. But it's still just, everything should just work. And it should just integrate properly. So that's basically it. And so the goal for me is to basically upload this to GitHub or something, and then hopefully people will basically start using this, trying it out, and basically help perfect this policy, because it's currently very limited. And the idea is to basically make it just like any other user session, but with the exception that this session is basically totally enforced, so to speak. So every process can only do what it needs to do and nothing else. That's the goal. But from a user experience perspective, it should just basically feel like any other session. So you should be able to run any application, do any kind of exotic stuff, without actually noticing that SELinux is actually enforcing its policy on the system, on the session. But to achieve that, well, that's just a huge task. Really, I can't overstate that, how hard that's going to be. We're now all at like almost 10,000 lines of policy, and it's just the bare base. So basically, I wouldn't be surprised if that basically the policy would be like 800,000 lines, and still would be buggy as hell. And at that point, you'll probably also get performance issues. There's already some performance issues with only 10,000 rules. So if you have like 100,000 rules, then SELinux will be really busy checking all the permissions. And of course, the policy will also be big. The policy is currently 0.5 MB compiled. So that's 10,000 lines. So if it like 100,000 lines, then it would be actually 10 times as much, so it's like 5 MB, I guess, or something like that. So yeah, the footprint will be bigger, and SELinux will be much busier testing everything. But the goal is to actually get there, and hopefully I will. I already ported it from Fedora 18 to Fedora 19, so I already took that pain to do that, which took a few days for me to do, I guess. And it's all standalone, so it's basically just a third party add-on. So in that sense, everything is done with the idea of you are able to update it easily. It integrates easily, so you won't break the existing policy. You won't do anything nasty to the system. at least the idea is that you won't open up the existing policy any more than it was already. And it's all self-contained, so everything should be in the policy, at least most of it, as much as possible. And so, yeah, you should be able to use that as a base and to improve it and to work over time to keep improving it, as long as Fedora policy stays the same, at least with respect to stuff that interacts with the user sessions and files that users operate on and stuff like that, then there shouldn't be a problem. So I'll try to support this as long as I can, and hopefully I will get some more feedback and people adding to the policy. It's going to be on GitHub, so, but that's probably wishful thinking. I'm probably the only one crazy enough to do this. I spent a couple of months on this 10,000 lines of policy. It's like 2 or 3 months working hard. And for someone who doesn't know the policy, it's kind of hard to basically get acquainted with the policy and basically start adding policy that basically goes by the same rules. So you basically need to understand some of the decisions I made. And you can find all those decisions in the policy, but if you study the policy, you can actually see, okay, so in that instance, I should go about it this way and allow this because of this design decision, allow that because of that design decision, and don't allow access to generic binaries unless they're really the core commands, like for example ls and cat and stuff like that, and shells. But anything else, don't allow your confined applications to run generic binaries and all that stuff. So basically that's what's up.